So thank you so much for coming for this evening's talk. Right now, I'm just going to kind of go over two cases, and one, there's one main case, and then there's this little short one. So I would like to start out with a two-year-old female spayed domestic short hair that presented for vomiting for several days, 5 to 7 days, and it would be water or food. And there is definitely a decrease in appetite. And about 2.5 weeks prior to this vomiting episode, the cat did have fever, lethargy, and decrease in appetite, and was treated at that time by the RDVM with oral doxycycline and sub-Q fluids, and did get better. He's a boy, actually. It's a male neutered. He is an indoor-outdoor cat. So what are some of your differentials and thought process for a vomiting cat daily and indoor-outdoor cat? The cat is not feeling great, but not flat out or anything like that. So just a little bit lethargic. Activity's gone down a little bit, but does eat, and then it comes it right out. So pancreatitis, inflammatory bowel disease. So
foreign body,
okay. Intussusception, great. And I'm sorry? Okay, doxycycline, so that's a good one. So whenever I'm looking at these kind of cases that are literally vomiting every day, that really bothers me, because even my IBD cases, unless they're really severe, there are definitely some that can do daily, but usually there's like once a week to once a month to once every 2-3 weeks. I feel like an animal that literally can't keep food or water down, that's not even typical for pancreatitis when you think about it, where most cats actually don't vomit with pancreatitis as opposed to dogs. But it's still a differential for sure. But it just bothers me that, wow, you really can't keep anything down. And then I start thinking of anatomical issues. So intussusceptions, foreign body, and then I think the doxycycline is a good one too. This is what I ended up doing. So the blood work was unremarkable. So you start out with, you know, basic blood work. It's an indoor-outdoor cat. Just know the FELV, FIV status. Totally negative. But it's really not really exciting on blood work. Okay. So remember, a lot of times primary intestinal disease does not show up on blood work. And a lot of times people are happy, oh, the blood work's normal. But actually, that still doesn't rule out inflammatory bowel disease or even definitely anatomical issues. In a 2.5-year-old cat getting like something like a tumor, it's not impossible, but it's not as likely. So I ended up saying, gosh, you just can't keep anything down. I just need to go down and take a look and maybe scope you. So the owner allowed me to do that, and this is what I saw when I first went in. I'm literally just about 1 or 2 centimeters into the esophagus, and it's pretty narrow. So it's very, very narrow. It should be nice and big, especially when you're inflating the esophagus. It really has a nice dilated look when you push it. I literally couldn't even pass anything through this thing. So what is this? What do you guys think this is? So it's a total stricture. So that's where, what is it caused by? Okay, so this is a doxycycline. So typically when an animal has a stricture from doxycycline, or quite honestly, anything that causes a stricture, on average, you know it's an ulceration about 360 degrees, okay? And on average, I would say that they start to become clinical about 2 to 3 weeks after the ulceration occurred.
Is that with the liquid too, or just?
Really the tablet, okay? The liquid is much better, because the thing about the liquid, at least it goes slides down. So even if you ulcerate, let's say, which most cats will start to get the liquid down, but if you ulcerate, let's say, just the ventral aspect of the esophagus, you're not going to be a 360. So the trick about this is a 360. Can you think about any other things that you would want to know aside from doxy? What else can cause something like that, 360-degree strictures or just esophageal strictures? So foreign body is a good one. Okay, what about in a cat in particular? Because usually with dogs, you know, they ate something, now they can't eat, and they're like choking on things, and then they're like can't swallow well. So we definitely had several foreign bodies that are like, you know, rawhide, that they sat in the esophagus for like a week or so. But what else would it cause in a cat in particular?
Esophagitis.
So esophagitis is more like what's causing esophagitis. So usually they're not going to be 360, typically. But you could definitely have irritation throughout. So the other one is actually hairballs. Sometimes when you think about the stomach acid soaked with acid, and it's like really, really low pH, and then they try to vomit it up, and it kind of gets stuck a little bit, and it sits there, and then eventually they work it out. And but then it's already done a 360, you know, contact of acid erosion, and then the ulceration occurs. The cat's still going to feel okay, but then later on it's going to start to heal, and then it starts contracting down. So hairball strictures I've seen also, and then what's one more? A foreign body. What's another one? And even foreign body, it really has to be a. I'd rather have a foreign body that is like almost like a flat type of material, like a rawhide, because they usually kind of get stuck in the esophagus, and then there'll be like 3 points of contact. So even they ulcerate, but then once you remove it, it's not a 360 ring. So they tend to not to be as bad as everything that's putting pressure necrosis on the whole mucosa. So what's another good one that often we'll see? And oftentimes I'll say, all right, your animal may have a stricture, and I'll ask for any kind of anesthetic procedures, okay? So what are some things that you could think of that would be very common for a stricture post-anesthetic, especially in general practice, because we don't do it. A dental. So remember, dental, because when you think about it, a lot of the refluxing is coming out of the esophagus, and then you guys have to turn that animal, right? Because you do one side and the other side. So they literally bathe the whole esophagus in a 360 ring. So I always get very, very concerned about any kind of anesthetic procedure. So the animal just keeps mommy, just should be thinking about, have you had been anesthetized 3 weeks ago or 2 weeks ago? And then have you had a doxycycline? So
is this cat actually vomiting though?
Yeah, so that's a good question. So technically it's not. Theoretically, this is not bile, so that's the other question you have to ask. Is there any kind of bile? This animal just comes out food and water. So anytime you see bile, theoretically that's a content of the stomach. However, it can be very tricky, just like if you have a megaesophagus dog, occasionally bile will come up because you're gagging so much because it's getting stuck in your pharyngeal region, and just like sticking your finger in your throat, it's uncomfortable. You actually will induce a gag reflex that you truly will vomit. So occasionally you will see bile, but majority of the time you'll see there's no bile, and that's how, because they can look horrific too. Even though I know that people talk about the pumping, the action, that's more vomiting versus passive, but sometimes when it's very violent, it can look pretty hard to differentiate between the two. Either case, this is a stricture from doxycycline. So then I eventually had to open it up because I couldn't even pass my, I had to use my smallest pediatric scope, and that's like maybe like 0.8 centimeters, like really, really small, or even like 0.5 centimeters. You'll see that this is kind of backing out, and then what's interesting, you see ulceration, also that this is all ulcerated right here. So it's actually like a large segment, okay? And this, see that rip? I did that. I opened that up to even get me through that that stricture. If you notice, it's not just a single stricture of like a really thin band of tissue. It literally is about 1 or 2 centimeters, about this one is about 2 centimeters. So I suspect the pill kind of got stuck, then maybe there's some kind of acid reflux. I don't know. It just starts to diffuse out, you know, but enough that it's about 1 or 2 centimeters. It doesn't have to be a single band. Because if it's a single band, it's actually easier to dilate and you're done. But this is why some of these are really, really hard to treat. And you can see it's kind of scary because you do have to rip it open. And how do we do that? It's balloon dilation. I had to start very, very small. We have a really tiny balloon, then we'll kind of start to inflate it more and more. And let me see if this is. I think this is a fifth day, a fifth balloon dilation. So now it's a little bit more open. You can see old scars, and you can see even some parts that were probably the bigger stricture part. And it looks horrible, but this is unfortunately what you have to do to truly open them up, because it literally scars so far down that you can't even get anything through. This cat, he came back today, and for his seventh dilation. So I used to dilate like twice a week, but this one was so severe that we had to do it for like 3 days back to back. So you just kind of anesthetize the next day again and keep opening, because you don't want it to heal. Because if you kind of do it once and you wait a week to dilate, then there's been several papers that show you, wow, it seals right back down to almost you did nothing. So now I tend to be more aggressive about multiple dilation. I say on average, you're going to need minimally probably 3 dilations, but sometimes a much more. And this one, when that little hole, when we kind of truly measure it, it was only about 3 millimeters. Okay, so there's definitely no kibble that can get through. And what's also difficult is that this hole was so small, because this cat can't eat or drink, really. Because if you start to drink too much water at once, because it's so proximal, there's not an area for the food or water to collect. it propels out pretty quickly. So that's what was so tough about this case. And we couldn't even pass an E-tube, you know, because E-tube would be great if we just kind of scope and just pop an E-tube. It's very, very non-invasive. And because I can't even pass my scope through to even get my forceps to open up to kind of grab your tube, we ended up having to do a surgical placement of the cat. So this is Rocky, and this is actually Rocky today. We took a picture of him because he was so funny because it says, I woke up like this, which is truly true because he probably like went under anesthesia, and next thing you know, he has a tube coming out of him, and he's like, but ultimately, we had to, again, surgically place a PEG tube. And then this is like the balloon. I tried to take a picture. There's like a little, there's a long line, and then it inflates and deflates. And this one, our maximum is 18 millimeters. And then you just have a syringe that you can put water or air through to dilate. The key thing is you always follow Doxy with food and water. And it's interesting because I know every vet tells the owner this, but they don't always hear it. And this is like, you know, $3,000, $4,000 later because you have to put a surgical tube on top of multiple balloon dilation. I always say that if a nurse is going, you know, if you guys are doing the discharges or the nurse is doing it, make sure they stress that this is a severe esophageal stricture drug. I feel like all pills have I always like to follow food or water because if you dry swallow a pill, it's uncomfortable, especially animals are in a horizontal position with their esophagus. And they've done studies where they actually put barium or like some type of contrast in little capsules and tablets, and they watch after dry pilling an animal, and it was like 90% or higher, they all still sat in the esophagus, even they swallowed it. And then yet only like a teaspoon of water is needed to push it all the way down. So it doesn't take much. So I always tell owners, after the pilling, just make sure you just have a syringe, just squirt just a tiny bit on the side of the mouth and just go for it. Again, this is something where the owner says, oh, I don't remember my vet telling me that. I know they did, you know? It's just that more they didn't always hear it. So our next case is a 2.5-year-old pit bull mix, male neutered, that has chronic history of nasal congestion and discharge. 3 to 4 weeks was the length of time that the owners noticed there was some sneezing, and sometimes it would be white, a little bit of cloudy discharge, and sometimes it would be bloody and sometimes purulent. And there's mild lethargy, but the dog kept on eating through most things, but just maybe activity just slowing down just a hair. The vet had tried 10-day course of doxycycline once a day, and then also tried prednisone once a day for 10 days at the same time with no improvement. But he still has a good appetite at this point when we saw him, and he is up to date on vaccines, heartworm, along with flea and tick preventative. On a dog like this with chronic nasal discharge, you know, the physical exam, what I'm really paying attention to is airflow. Is it unilateral or bilateral? I like more of the cotton ball method where you kind of take a wisp and probably break your cotton ball a little bit and just put it in front. I feel like it's more sensitive to me than a slide. And a lot of times, if you just do that, because the animal's very nervous, they almost like stop breathing or they don't take heavy breaths, I'll make my nurses run back and forth, you know, to really get excited. And then they'll stop in front of me and I'll close his mouth and then put it in. Then you'll see this, you know, heavy breathing. They really can see the movement of the flow much better. And then obviously palpate for submandibular lymph node enlargements, ocular retropulsion, and really a good oral exam. And then look for symmetry in the face, and then look for nasal depigmentation. And really, if you can, open the mouth and you can see any kind of change in the soft palate. But I say majority of the time, even with masses and such, you don't always see that big bulge coming out from the soft palate, because most of the time you're going to be in the hard palate and it's not going to make a dent. But particularly in cats, occasionally you have that young kitten that's a nasopharyngeal polyp, you will see a nice bulge poking through the ventral deviation of the soft palate. And look for pain. And then, of course, the generalized exam, petechiations, fundic exam, that's a really good area. You'll see a little bit of, you know, low platelet cases that have, you know, some type of bloody discharge. But usually they're not going to, of course, they're not going to be purulent. I rectal, obviously, all my cases, but what you're really paying attention is, you know, do you see black feces? Because a lot of times they are swallowing blood and they are bleeding more than we realize, because they don't have to go forward bleeding. I have several cases that are just going postnasal drips and they're swallowing it. I feel like the rectal exam is like reading tea leaves. They have so much information. I don't feel people do enough, because I know the interns that go through, it's like it's all about the rectal, because you can feel the urethra, you know what the, you know, poop looks like, you know the consistency, because 9 times out of 10 the owners don't even know what the stool looks like. This is Brutus. He's a really nice dog. We just have an e-collar on him, though. Shoot out some differentials. Just throw it out there. Chronic nasal discharge, been several weeks, not responsive to prednisone and doxycycline.
Tooth root abscess.
Okay, so that's a good one. So in a two-and-a-half-year-old dog, I'm not going to say it's not impossible, but their teeth are usually pretty nice, but that's still good to thought. Foreign body, yes, a lot of dogs occasionally will get that, something stuck up the nose. And usually with how do I know about foreign body, I always wonder, like, when the dog starts sneezing, when you have something up the nose, they cannot stop. I mean, they're, like, usually coming on emergency or to your clinic. It's not this, like, I'm sneezing, but then I've resolved. And usually they literally just can't stop sneezing. So if, at least it's if it's acute onset of a foreign body, but not impossible.
Like a bacterial infection, too, that could disease water.
Yeah, so is it inappropriate antibiotics? You need stronger antibiotics because it's a bacterial infection. Just remember, the nasal flora, there's tons of bacteria. So I think it is pretty rare to get primary bacterial infection in the dog. You have to say, well, why are you blocked? Why is there blockage of airflow that's making you have this discharge? In fact, I feel like all cases of bacterial rhinitis, it's always secondary to something else. Here are some of the thoughts, and I'm sure some of you guys already said this. So neoplasia, pretty young dog, but we have had pretty young dogs with neoplasias in the nose even, so it's kind of unusual. Foreign body, trauma, dental disease, especially oral nasal fistulas, inflammatory infectious like aspergillosis and lymphoplasmacytic rhinitis. If this is a cat, do they get aspergillosis in the nose? Yep, that's right. So they don't usually get aspergillosis. That's not usually on my differential for a cat. Then I think of cryptococcus. The back to your frustrating bacterial rhinitis is a really secondary to often lymphoplasmacytic rhinitis. So it's like an inflammatory nasal lining disease, and they get inflamed, and then they can't have good airflow, and then they're very, very frustrating. They're like the ones that we think about the cats. That's more typical. But occasionally you have these handful of dogs that we really don't know the cause, and it's almost impossible to treat like as a curative, but we can relieve some of their symptoms. But it is one of the more frustrating ones. And just an interesting side note, retrospective studies for epistaxis in dogs, it was just kind of a breakdown of 176 cases. Neoplasia is probably the highest up there, and then you have trauma, idiopathic rhinitis, at least just in this paper. And then periapical abscesses. And a lot of times when I have the dental disease, I mean, you'll see this bulge on their nose, you know, and eventually it might pop out and open. But occasionally, especially like the dachshund, they like to just do it in their nose, and it doesn't really deform the face, but they definitely get a higher rate of oral nasal fistulas. And systemically, for epistaxis, again, this is a little bit different than just purulent material, is thrombocytopenia, thrombocytopathy, coagulopathy, hypertension, and vasculitis. What are some of the diagnostic tests for a chronic, you know, nasal discharge? Just going to throw out some. Okay, so skull rads. Okay, culture.
Cytology.
Scope. Cytology. CT. Nasal flush. You know, maybe some of these things are in your mind right now. So obviously basic blood work, make sure systemically or the immune, you know, system is all intact, everything looks good otherwise. Well, often we'll do is for us, you know, because usually there's going to be some procedure. And for me, by far, this is what I would do. A CBC, CT, rhinoscopy. And then oftentimes a biopsy. Now, this is assuming that it fits, because obviously blood pressure, if you just only have epistaxis, you should do that. If you have a coagulopathy and only epistaxis, you know, no mucopurulent discharge, you know, you would think about other things. If you have an older animal, you definitely want to look for metastasis. But remember, it tends to be locally aggressive, and a lot of times they don't met to the chest. And then lymphedone aspirates, if they happen to be really large, occasionally you can get a metastatic sublumbar mandibular lymph node enlargement that might be helpful. And some people may talk about fungal serology, and I'll kind of go over to that more. And then CT rhinoscopy, I really think, is a key. Now, I know people mention nasal cytology and nasal culture. I never culture my nasal discharge. It's like culturing your poop. It just doesn't, you're going to have a natural, normal flora. there's really no pathogenic bacteria that you're going to culture out. So I feel I have yet to find it rewarding. If you want to choose your antibiotics based on that culture, I feel like you're never going to get rid of it, because you have to find out, why are you building up this nasal discharge? Why is there not good flow and flushing of the nasal cavity? That is going to be the key. And even cytology could be really tricky. I don't think it's ever wrong, for sure, because it's so easy to do in hospital, but to send it out, to spend, I don't know, like IDEX, I think it's like, I don't know, $150, $200 and some. I just think it's oftentimes I've yet to find a diagnosis based on a cytology, unless I took a biopsy and it takes about 3 days to 5 days to get the results, 5 to 7 days to get results back. I might roll that tissue sample on a slide just to get a quicker look. And what cancer am I thinking of, particularly in the cat? So nasal lymphoma in the cat. So that I would say yes. But dogs, unfortunately, you're going to think about a tumor. How are you going to get that sample? You know, you're going to grab it blindly, and I'll kind of go over in more detail. It can be very tricky because the nasal cavity is just so intricate. You know, I'll kind of go over that more. And it's just so much more clear and crisp on CT compared to any kind of skull radiographs you guys can take. And quite honestly, even with skull radiographs, you have to go under general anesthesia to really get proper skull films. And I feel like the cost is not, when you think about what you're gaining, I think that you get so much more, especially when you think about the cribriform plate. It's really important you're looking at that, because is there any tumor that's eating away at the cribriform plate? Is there a fungal organism eating away at the cribriform plate? And these things will make a huge difference on prognosis and treatment options. This is a rhinoscopy. So after we saw the CT, we're like, ooh, this is interesting. And it kind of looks really suspicious of fungus, because it wasn't like a single mass that's kind of expanding out, especially the sinus. You'll see this periphery is like there's soft tissue density around the sinus lining. And then so we went in there, and then you see these, funky greenish yellow areas. It's not throughout. It's just little spots. And then, of course, when you're looking at it, then we can go ahead and biopsy it, okay? And then it's very, very precise in what you're looking at, and then you grab your thing. So, obviously, what's your diagnosis? So, aspergillosis, okay? So this is sinonasal aspergillosis. It's the second most common cause of nasal discharge in dogs after neoplasia. But it's the fumigate goddess is the most common type, but there are others. The flavus and Niger and nigulans is the other ones. But quite honestly, that's really academic. If it looks like an aspergillosis, it doesn't matter what type you have. The treatment is still going to be the same. So it does tend to invade in the nasal cavity and often into the frontal sinuses and into the lungs and into the other parts of the body. Disseminated disease is actually quite rare, or less common, I should say. So who gets it? Dolichocephalic animals and then mesocephalic animals. Middle age, large-sized dogs are more likely to be affected. If you look at the mean age for a dog with aspergillosis, it tends to be about 4.4 years, as opposed to 9.5 years for nasal masses in canines. And definitely some dogs seem to be a little bit more susceptible to others. I mean, off my head, I feel like the Rottie is a little bit overrepresented, because I just had like 3 Rotties, thinking about which ones I've had to treat for. But definitely I feel like sometimes the immunity is maybe not as strong. But theoretically, it's still a little bit different than the disseminated form, which I'll go into. But theoretically, any dog can get this. And it's localized tissue damage or the nasal mucosa that may be the predisposing factor for the infection. Typically, you're going to see mucopurulent or bloody discharge, and it often starts unilateral but eventually can progress to bilateral. And you'll often see sneezing and often pain in the nose. And what's interesting is deep pigmentation is often seen, especially ulcerations, which I feel like that's kind of unique compared to other causes of nasal discharge. And the depigmentation is thought maybe it's caused by the toxin from the fungus. But again, if you see like nasal tumors that have nasal discharge, you don't have that unique depigmentation. But of course, advanced cases of any kind of invasion into your sinuses will kind of cause deformation of the nose, the nasal cavity, and it can start eating away at the bone. So it can actually have a lot of unusual face shape, but they have to be pretty aggressive and chronic to get to that point. sometimes the animal is a little bit lethargic and anorexic. So how do you diagnose it? Really, it's histopath, CT, rhinoscopy, and I put a question mark on serology and fungal culture. I really don't feel like you need this for diagnosis, and you'll see why. You can see that here, it's like normal in the nasal cavity, but then it starts to invade. So it really doesn't, it can happen anywhere along the nasal cavity. It's not like throughout, necessarily. So you really need multiple exams to kind of come to this conclusion. Because it's opportunistic, it's really everywhere in the environment. And it is often found in the normal nasal cavity of the dog. So if you actually try to culture it, you can sometimes get a positive in 30-40% in healthy dogs. So I do feel like culture is not always something that we typically do, because you really need to see the invasion into the tissue itself. And then you'll often see of foreign plant material. That's probably where it kind of starts out, where there's some kind of plant material that goes up the nose and it has some spores on it, then it dissolves and that goes away, but then now it's seeded. And then a lot of times you can inhale a large amount of fungal spores. I find it interesting, there's some information about in people, I guess these asexual spores are everywhere. And they're easily distributed throughout the air, you know, once it's kind of disturbed in releasing it from the soil. The average human inhales about 200 spores a day. So I found that's interesting. And then in healthy people, it's really clear by mucociliary defenses and phagocytized by alveolar macrophages. And then once they start to germinate with the hyphae, that's when your neutrophils will kind of eat up the fungal hyphae. The other ones that we've seen with this is, again, it's opportunistic, is sometimes there's radiation patients. You know, we did have a dog that had a nasal tumor, had radiation, and then ultimately has a big hole in the head, and then had aspergillosis. So sometimes if there's a break into the bone or something damaged to the tissue itself or neoplasia can predispose you to this. CT, I feel like if you had to choose one thing, CT by far is, I think it could be very, very helpful. Ideal to see if really your cribriform plate is intact, because that really affects treatment options. And you also get to appreciate the extent of disease. And oftentimes it is bilateral, but on CT we see it in about 15-20% cases bilateral. And again, it is much, much more detailed to do CT than radiographs, like skull films. What you're looking for is really turbinate lysis and soft tissue or fluid opacities, and then reactive bone remodeling or osteolysis. And a lot of times you'll see this mixed opacity like we saw on Brutus, the fungal granuloma like lining the tissue. On our computer, you can really see the turbinates really well, so I apologize, when we were going through the CT, you really couldn't see it. But this is how intricate, you know, the turbinates are. And I think a lot of people, especially owners, they really think that there's just two holes in the nose and you just go up and there's a gigantic hole. It's not. It's actually, there's only so many meatuses that you can go through when you're doing rhinoscopy. So it's very intricate. And you're just not going to get the detail on skull films, because this is like cross-sectional, you can see, versus on radiographs. And then you can really see the beautiful lining of the cribriform plate, like the skull, you know, the bone that surrounds the brain. Because a lot of times they will start eating away, and then you can have neurologic signs and such. And then you can see the sinuses so well. There's like this thickened area, you know, along the sinuses. So again, this is Brutus's CT. And that's why, remember when you look above the soft palate, we could do a retroflex when you stick a camera and you go, when you make a U-turn, you can look on top of the soft palate, and then you're looking at that space right here. And that's why I always do CT first, because sometimes I don't want to waste their money on retroflex when I know I'm going to see nothing. You know, this is all like higher up in the sinuses and such, as opposed to something that's blocking. Sometimes we'll see masses right above that's called the choana area. And obviously this one would be a waste of money and time if you're trying to do a retroflex. So you can see on the left slide, you just see the turbinate destruction. So this is really beautiful right turbinates, and then it's all gone. And then on the right, you just see the fluid and some of the soft tissue opacity in the cavity, and they're probably granulomas. Okay. Tissue, granulomatous tissue. There's been several studies, but this one's a really good one that looked at, you know, skull films versus CT. It's very clear that you can see so much more. Like this line is where this CT image would be versus this line would be here. So I personally, if you didn't, you know, I have a hard time just seeing, okay, what's there? You just know there's soft tissue opacity, but you don't know that's fluid. It could be mucus. That could really look like a rhinitis case, you know. And even like a foreign body or something, but it's just not clear enough for me where the cost of CT typically is around $1,400 to $1,600. It does require general anesthesia, and that includes contrast. And I just feel like for bang for your buck, you're going to do the client so much better than trying to take multiple skull films and then still not and run these different tests where you just need to look at it inside. So rhinoscopy, you'll see destruction of turbinates, and you'll see fungal plaque sometimes, and can sometimes look like dark color masses. But the frontal sinus is one that can be a little bit difficult to get with rhinoscopy. I mean, sometimes if you have a more flexible scope, with a very small pediatric one, you can go up and guide yourself up to the frontal sinus, but it's a tricky method, and you can really break your scope that way. So. Typically, we use the rigid, but again, I have the advantage of having the CT first to kind of tell me where I need to go. Literally, the sampling technique is so critical in trying to get a diagnosis, because if you're in the wrong area and you can't visualize it, you'll miss the diagnosis. You need to know what you're looking at, but you have to grab the sample because it's multifocal distribution or very focal distribution sometimes. And the impression smears can be helpful, but I really think biopsy is going to be the best. A lot of times we'll biopsy, smear it, then we get to see our answer, then we'll send it off for a histopath. And remember that inflammation is often lymphocytic plasmacytic to neutrophilic. On the histopath, the results, usually they'll kind of have some key words that, you know, this dog has mucosal ulcerations, and they just see lymphocytes and plasmacytes. But what's interesting is that they'll call this sometimes, if they don't see the fungus, they'll even call it idiopathic lymphocytic plasmacytic rhinitis. So that does bother me, because sometimes we do get that diagnosis. If an animal did have a CT, how do we know for sure that this is not a true fungal? That's why you can never get rid of it, and the treatment is never successful with antibiotics. Because sometimes they do need a little antibiotic help, but obviously the primary cause is a fungal. So it just happens to be the actual biopsy. I don't know if you guys all use IDEX now, but it's kind of cool because they'll get it on your phone and it'll send you the images and such. So this is Brutus's, and you just see these like kind of ghosty wisp of hyphae in the biopsy. So what about serology? So a positive serology can be supportive of rhinitis, fungal rhinitis, but you really need other confirmatory tests. So there is the AGID test, and that detects antibodies. And it's kind of not really great in its sensitivity, okay? It's about a third will be false negative. The reason probably is because it may not detect all forms of aspergillosis. But the specificity is better, but you really want a very sensitive test if you're really kind of looking at your first test. But I never use it because I could see the fungal organism in the scope, and on CT could be very highly suspicious. And in humans, I know there's another sandwich enzyme assay that no one really uses because it's really poor sensitivity at 23%. So the key point that if you run a serology, you also have the concern of 5 to 15% will be false positives too. So then you're really kind of stuck with what do your dog really have if you only run a blood test. But if you want to and you everything else that you've done is kind of negative, I guess you can do it. But again, I feel like without CT rhinoscopy, I'd rather just not bank on the serology. And then PCR is even worse. It has a really, really poor sensitivity. And the reason is that you're collecting blood, right? And then sometimes it really doesn't invade into the bloodstream because it's very locally invasive. And what about fungal culture? It takes forever. Like 1 to 2 weeks. Remember, normal dogs can have this fungus growing in their nose, so I do find it not really helpful. So let's talk about treatment. The best treatment for this disease is really directly infusion into the nasal cavity and sinuses. Oftentimes we will link it up with oral treatment, but literally oral alone is not going to work because it's very locally aggressive. And you cannot get enough drug therapeutic levels within the tissue itself when you just give something systemically. But of course, sometimes we have no choice when there's actually invasion of the cribriform plate or there's a lot of extra nasal structures that are involved. So with oral therapy, again, low success rate of clearing the disease, but it may decrease the clinical symptoms a little bit. And we're usually treating until there's no clinical signs. And I kind of tend to treat at least 1 month beyond. resolution of signs. And really, anytime you are on any of the azoles, like usually it's itraconazole typically, but there's a lot of newer ones too, you want to make sure you do a liver panel. But they're definitely less toxic than it used to be for the ketoconazole, but still it's something that you do want to do liver panels for. And sometimes they can cause vomiting or diarrhea as a side effects for the itraconazoles or any of the azoles. Anecdotally, terbinafine has been used with the azoles also. And the other one, there's a newer generation, but that's really good activity, but super, super expensive. And that's voriconazole and posaconazole are the two big ones. Again, this sometimes is the only option where the cribriform plate is not intact. So topical, typically, the two you'll hear the most is clotrimazole and inaconazole. I actually prefer inaconazole, but this case that just came in, it was like, what, I think 3 weeks ago or so that we treated. I was trying to get inaconazole because usually we have it, but ours kind of expired because it's a pesticide. You know, we get it from Sigma. And a lot of people like the inaconazole because when you actually infuse it, even the vapors of this compound will actually be fungicidal or destroys the fungus. So you're not only using it on contact, but it's also has a vapor form. But it's horrible. It's like smells. It's probably really toxic. I'm probably going to, like, I don't know, lose 2 years of my life. But the main thing is it is hard to get now because we ordered it without a problem. Then I tried to have our person order it, and they said, now you need a pesticide license. So I'm sure the EPAs probably are batching down on which animals or who can get pesticides. But that's the problem getting inaconazole. The other big one is clotrimazole. So that one you have to, there's like this, like, cream form, and then there's some of them that are all that are made in a different formulation that has alcohol in it, so you don't want any of that because that's very, very caustic. So typically we put it in the polyethylene glycol, and you have to have it compounded. All the topical azoles have very poor solubility, but it has minimal intestinal absorption, and they're typically fungicidal as opposed to fungistatic, you know, like the azoles. And of course, they all need to get general anesthesia for this procedure. And if you can, you could try to debride as best you can before you infuse. And they are 1 hour infusions. A lot of the compounding pharmacies, because I was looking at the internal medicine website, there's some that would get the powder form and they would just buy the PEG 300 solution from anywhere and kind of mix it up on their own, but most compounding pharmacies I found won't allow that. You have to buy the whole, you know, they'll make it for you. So usually I order like 200 mLs of it, so for the average dog. So this is why it's kind of tricky, because if you're in a CT rhinoscopy and you see it, it'd be nice to just go ahead and proceed with an infusion right then and there, but a lot of times you have to do a two-phase system because you have to kind of get the drug and then have it, you know, schedule what to make sure surgery can, or somebody can trephinate. So there are different papers on topical infusions and success rate. So there's an old paper that actually, when you actually surgically place tubes into the frontal sinuses, and then you put inaconazole, and you do it twice a day for one to 2 weeks, is 90% effective. And it's pretty traumatic in general when you're kind of drilling holes into the sinuses, but it does seem to work in this paper. Now we tend to do the non-surgically placed intranasal catheters with topical clotrimazole. And I do have to say the clotrimazole is not as caustic. It doesn't have that horrible fume that you have with the inaconazole. But typically success rate is like 65% after one treatment and up to 87% after two treatments. I've been, knock on wood, very lucky that, I should take it back because it was inaconazole that I've always done and it was always 100% successful. Usually I tell owners 65 to 75% of them can respond with just single treatment. There's another paper that talks about inaconazole having 57% success rate with one treatment, 94% after two to three treatment, and debridement definitely had to help improve that statistic. To stress, if you're even thinking about topical infusions, you have to have the cribriform plate intact. The trephination is nice because then you really can get access to the frontal sinuses and it allows a little bit of debridement. And I find it interesting that some of them are just in the frontal sinuses. About 17% of fungal plaques are just in the sinuses, and they're not even in the nasal cavity. So you can miss things, even though they'll still have discharge and everything, but it's just kind of draining down from the sinuses. This is our Dr. Roach. So usually I have to get a surgeon involved. Even I know it sounds like pretty easy to just poke a hole, but anything with sharp objects, because it's an internist, it's probably very dangerous. I could probably imagine losing an eye, you know, myself or the dog. But the main thing is he will help me poke a hole into the sinuses. And this one, I only did the right side. Originally, I was attempting to do both sides, but the CT really looked pretty clean on the other side. And now that there's been several studies where you actually infuse it without even trephination, you can actually fill up the whole sinuses still yet, even with just intranasal infusion. So I felt like, because there was a little suspicious area, but not enough for me to have to go in and debride. This is where he is putting a pen in to hand drill a hole. I don't know, I assume it's called a pin. I don't know, maybe a screwdriver. I don't know, there's some kind of surgical instrument that you could poke a hole through the skull. So, and then
Ice pick, yes.
And then this is a curettage, so he's kind of scraping out some of the stuff that he's able to see, and I'm using my scope to help guide him. And he's actually opening up the hole just a little bit more. Then I would put my scope in, and I could see the stuff that's in the sinuses. So then I'll like literally direct, and I'll say, hey, can you go ahead and dig out a little bit more there? Then I'll redirect, and then we can kind of go back and forth to clean out as best we can. And this is kind of the placement of the tubes. There's like, you know, 5 billion tubes in this procedure. Literally, you will have one large Foley that you have to block the esophagus, okay? And you'll pack it with some gauze. And then you have another Foley that you're going to make a U-turn above the soft palate. So this one's a little bit tricky because you literally have to kind of use a technique where you pass a red rubber tube, then you could go through the nose, and then it comes out. Then you could kind of grab it, and then you could tie another suture, and then the suture will tie onto this Foley. Then you start pulling it through the nose, and you can kind of get this retroflex angle for the Foley to kind of make a U-turn on the palate. Then you'll have the polypropylene catheters that are actually where the infusion will take place. So why you're doing that? Because of course you're blocking that dorsal soft palate. So because once you infuse, you really don't want anything seeping through, and so it's going to be all in the nose and into the sinuses, and you don't want any leakage. So we still pack it with a lot of gauze, and you definitely still want a big Foley so they don't swallow in their esophagus, because this is pretty messy stuff that you're hoping nothing will seep out. And I learned the hard way, because anaconazole I feel is a lot more toxic, because one of my cases, everything went really well. In that one, we trephinated, and then it starts to seep out. And then, unfortunately, he ulcerated his eyes. You can't tell, because you know, he's under anesthesia. And then the dog did great, as in from the fungal standpoint, but his cornea was really damaged from ulceration. So this one I got really nervous about, so I was going to try to pack it and, you know, block the eye, because the inoconazole, again, is so caustic. You're supposed to put Vaseline all around the eyes, and also you goop up the whole lining of the mouth, because any of that contact is very, very caustic compared to clotrimazole. So the nice about clotrimazole is that it's not as scary, but it's just something that you think about, where this stuff is pretty caustic potentially. So this is Brutus. So he's under. So now, because I didn't want anything to seep out from that trephination, we went ahead and trephinated just to curettage as much as we could, and then I just have him close it up. And once we closed it up, I start to infuse, literally. So again, you have the different tubes that are going through to block the pharynx, and use a really big polypropylene. So you have to, you know, 15 minutes on sternal position, then 15 minutes on the left side down, and then right side down, and then you let it, and you have to constantly infuse, because it's going to start to drain out a little bit, start to seep out a little bit. And then we also, like, one side we kind of started with just suturing the nares shut just a little bit better. But there are Foleys in the nasal cavity too, so it's blocking it. But it still wants to kind of seep, so you kind of constantly have to add a few more, CCs every so often to make sure you're filling up the sinuses. So what are the complications? Really, pharyngitis is only transient. Again, clotrimazole is not as caustic as inoconazole, and the corneal ulceration. And then If the cribriform plate is not intact, that's why I would never do this procedure without a CT, because the dog will have neurologic signs and die, pretty much. Because you're going to infuse it into the brain. So treatment success, really a 65 to 100%. I always tell owners about 65 to 75% for one time. But typically, they'll be willing that we could do it again and again. It's hard to tell you what is success rate, because sometimes this disease can come back like months later or 6 months later, and this is what's so frustrating, because it can come back, and maybe it was original infection in the first place that never cleared. But don't only look at nasal discharge as your criteria of success, okay? Because a lot of these guys, they can still have a little bit of nasal discharge even after having this disease process, because their lining is not normal. They have no turbinates anymore, so they tend to be sensitive to true secondary bacterial rhinitises. And hopefully you really don't see any more plaques and negative histopathology and negative culture. But again, most people, they're not going to re-scope these guys. You know, but if you really want to be thorough, you can anesthetize and take a look again. But I have yet to do that. The prognosis, it really depends on the extent of the extranasal involvement in response to the initial therapy. And they most will do quite well. Recurrence rate is pretty rare. But remember, if there's extensive turbinate damage, you will have persistent chronic nasal discharge. So the owner's goal is to have no discharge. That's not going to happen. But at least it will be hopefully more serious. And not as uncomfortable for the dog. And sometimes you will need secondary bacterial rhinitis treatment, because their immune system for that nasal cavity is not normal anymore, because you lost the barrier, the defense mechanism. Sometimes to look at success, you don't usually want to use serology as your response to treatment, because I was taught long time ago, but then there's several papers out that literally, even if you have successful treatment, the titers can still be high for up to 5 years. You know, so the serology is not as helpful. Versus you'll see me sometimes use Blasto, you know, the other fungal disease, where you'll use the Miravista antigen, and I'll see, all right, is it negative? I'll kind of keep treating until that it's negative, and I'll go like several months beyond that. Versus aspergillosis, I don't think it's going to be as valuable. And just interesting enough, there have been a case report where there's three dogs that had sinonasal tumors 13 and 30 months after the topical clotrimazole treatment. I just find it interesting. So maybe it's carcinogenic, maybe it's an inflammatory response. We don't know what induced it. But again, it's a very small case series, so you can't necessarily make cause and effect connections. So really the gold standard is visualization and confirmation of the fungal elements on histology. And literally visualization of the nasal plaques on rhinoscopy. This is now kind of jumping to the zebra diagnosis, where this is pretty rare, but it's not something that can't occur, and that's really the systemic aspergillosis. And usually they're going to be coming through neurology service. They're neurologic, and they can be ataxic and dull. Occasionally just really, really sick, and a lot of times they will invade into the kidney, spleen, lymph nodes, liver, heart, bladder, prostate, I mean, pretty much throughout the whole body. And it's the thought is probably came through the respiratory tract and then went through hematogenous spread, and it started to seed. And that's why you'll see a lot of times in the intervertebral discs, it's like a discospondylitis. Really, since 2012, there's only been 23 case reports, and it does go through the whole body system. So there was a case report that kind of showed an animal that you'll see the sternum, then you'll see that the sternum brain has like totally collapsed, and there's a proliferation of this bone, and that really obscures the joint space. And then, so it's a like an osteomyelitis. And then ultimately, you also see that the vertebrae here is also abnormal, and it's actually compressing on the spinal cord. So that's why a lot of times they're neurologic. So the disc space that's normally there is totally gone. And then when they actually looked at it, you could see just obviously different hyphae within embedded. And this is, it's almost impossible to treat, hence the tissue samples, I guess, because you'll unfortunately they'll be on the necropsy. And then you'll see like fungal hyphae invasion into these kidneys too. And it's a different strain. It's Pterius and Deflectus is the most common. And that's why the AGID doesn't test for this. And then there's a new one called Versicolor. And this one, unlike the nasal the nasal aspergillosis, is that they often are immune compromised. They're diabetics on chemotherapy or glucocorticoids. The German Shepherd seems to be overrepresented. And about 4 to 5 years is the mean age, and female to male ratio is about 3 to 1. So a lot of times they'll kind of come in with paresis or paraplegia, and again, it's often the discospondylitis. So treatment for this, unfortunately, is just support, and then you can only go with the oral and some of the IV. But just remember, with aspergillosis, fluconazole just really doesn't work. And then you can do the amphotericin B with the itraconazole. But remember, the amphotericin B is really static and nonsidal, and it's definitely nephrotoxic, so you really have to try to get the lipid base form. That'd be a little bit better. It's a little bit less toxic and better tissue penetration. Sometimes there's controversy, at least in human medicine, they talked about the azoles. Since the amphotericin B is supposed to bind to the ergosterol within the fungal wall, and then it causes the membrane to leak. But the problem with the azoles will inhibit the ergosterol. So that's why you combine the two, maybe it might not be as effective, but it is very commonly used to use both. So then some other ancillary things, again, would be the terbinafine. This can work synergistically with azoles. The people that probably use it most is dermatology people for malassezia, dermatitis. And again, totally anecdotal. No, there's no papers that says, yes, this will work for the aspergillosis. That's something to think about, too. And there's like some new type of stuff for human side that prevents some of the cell wall synthesis. You kind of cannons. It's a totally different family of drugs. Okay. I think that's it. Do you guys have any questions?
After you do the infusion and flip the dog, do you suction off the like residual?
That's a good question. So usually you have to make the dog tilt his head and just let it drain out. So I don't let it.
Do you flush it out, or do you just?
I don't flush it out. I just drain until it's gone, okay. Because I'm afraid if I flush it and I'm gonna lose some of that contact and dilute it. The whole point is about it's a contact killer, you know, type of thing. So. So you just let it drain and drain. And the dog did really well, surprisingly. Did it go home that night?
Yeah.
I think it did. I don't know. So
no, it was the next day. It was the next day.
I think we were just worried about the trepanation, how painful it would be, yeah. You know, waking up. But he did really well. So, it's a really sucky disease because it's just so expensive sometimes. I think this procedure to treat, I'd say, I think it was around like $1,600, $1,800, maybe something like that. But remember, you still have to do a CT prior. So that's just treatment costs. You have to do rhinoscopy again, and this was like a 3-hour procedure. I mean, it sounds like 1-hour infusion, but it's like getting everything ready, the trepanation. That definitely extends the time. And there's been some study where they just didn't trepanate at all. You know, I could have gone that route. Because they did a study where they actually see how well does it infuse into the sinuses. It does, but I always feel like if you could debride a little bit, because especially seeing the sinuses, I feel like we got to kind of peel some of that stuff off to really get penetration of the clotrimazole within. So.
But you didn't infuse directly into the sinuses.
So my other one I used to do, I would, and it was just such a mess. It would just kind of drip out. So it was kind of cool because since you could see the hole, you know, and I have a, you know, I could stick my scope in there too. But like literally, I start pushing it in. To the through the nasal cavity, then you could just see it rise up. You could see the sinuses fill up. So I knew it was filling up beautifully. So then I'm like, oh, I don't need to look at it and watch it. So I'd rather just like sew it up. So then nothing will seep out. So I feel like if I closed it, it might just kind of trap it in there even better versus constantly seeping. You know, I was so afraid of getting corneal ulcers and such. So that's why I just ended up closing it.
Do the disseminated dogs come in with a fever?
They can, yeah. I mean, they look like just like disco cases. They can have fever, really painful, and lethargic. They're just definitely much more sick compared to the sinonasal form where they're just kind of happy, but they have chronic nasal discharge. So they are quite sick. I mean, if you get a disseminated case, I feel like the chances are, unfortunately, sometimes you don't know, is it a disc? You know, a German Shepherd, we do sometimes get disc disease or lumbosacral disc protrusions. I just feel like it could be really tricky to say, oh, it's not something that we can help. So usually we go through the MRI process and such. Do you guys have any other questions? All right, appreciate it. Thank you so much.